So it's basically a thing which has a electronic, which has some kind of software, which has some sensors, and which has network connectivity, and which basically can send some data and basically collect data and do some kind of things in the device, or like from the cloud you do some kind of business thing which is useful for driving the business. So it can be a button. So I have seen this, how many of you have seen this basketball, which has some sensors, like I have played with this basketball. I hope it's not available in Sri Lanka. Like you can have this basketball and you just basically throw the ball and it goes into the basket, but still it will tell you like whether your shot was correct or not. Like it, if like I tried that one, so it fell in the basket. So it says no, it's still not correct. It's not 45 degrees. So likewise, it gives more information. So it helps the coach or somebody to teach you some kind of sports like accurately. Like normally, if you don't use these technologies, you can't exactly measure whether it is 45 degrees or something like that, right? So the other one is like the tennis. So I have seen this tennis with the ball, like you hit the ball and they will tell you, like the coach will basically looking at the phone itself, no, this is wrong, you have to improve your shots or something like that, right? So then, so I was listening to this Samsung, one of the sessions, so this guy who presented was from Olympic, right? He said, this Olympic, that is 2016, right? 2016, you can see the US medal tally, that's it. Only one single statement, he said. So what is that? What does that mean? So he said, using this IoT, we are going to change, like you will see the medal tally, which will go up. So let's see, another 1 year. So the thing is very simple. So when the athlete is running, he can have some kind of wearable IoT stuff, which can basically measure how he is running. Let's say take for an example, a person who is running. Let's say Carl Lewis no more. So who else? Like Usain Bolt, okay? So Usain Bolt, maybe his world record is 9.52, right? Now with this technology, with this wearable and this IoT stuff and the data which is going to come out, so you can analyze a lot of things. So let's say he's running 100 meters from point A to B. Now you can exactly measure how many steps he has used to finish that 100 meter race. So let's say if he has taken 30 steps, whether if increasing the step would have reduced the timing, or like the angle which he was like running for the first three steps or the next step might improve his speed. So these are the things which are going to come out of this IoT stuff. And so basically IoT is nothing but these four things. So you can also like basically start creating your own IoT devices. So actually this IoT device, a new jargon word, we already had that. Only thing was like the data which is going to go, and we are going to do some analysis and get something out of it, which is going to drive your business, okay? So it's going to be a network of things which where all these devices will be communicating. It can be from one machine to another machine, or it can be from machine to a cloud where you do some analysis of your data, right? So let's see some of the applications before I go into analytics, because only then you will understand like what we are going to do with this data. Like unless and otherwise, if I tell you the application, you won't be able to figure out what we are going to do with this. Okay, so let's see some of the applications, some interesting stuff as well. So healthcare, I have seen this baby suit. So you can have a baby suit which has some sensor which can detect the baby's temperature, so many other stuff, so the mother can sleep peacefully, right? So it gets all the data, and if there's something wrong, it will basically, it's going to do something, right? The other one, it's basically a wearable sensor. You can detect the ECG, heart rate, respiration rate, activity level, so many other stuff. Aging, you can have different sensors, and if you have your grandfather or somebody else who is very old, you can monitor their movement, and based on that, so you might be working, so you can basically see what their movement is, and based on that you can analyze some, get some useful stuff out of it, right? So likewise, smartphone sensors, like monitor your movements, location, workout, glow caps, your wife knows like whether you are taking the tablet or not if you are a diabetes patient, okay? So she can figure out, okay, my husband is okay, fine, he is. And the other one is something which is interesting, a pill sensor. So a pill sensor may be like you have a sensor, you drink and the sensor goes inside your body, okay? So let's see a small video of what is going to happen.
Today, vital signs such as heart and respiratory rate are generally measured through skin contact using external devices like ECG and pulse oximetry, and now with various wearable devices. But what if you could measure vitals without touching the skin? Here, we describe technologies using a miniature microphone that senses essential vitals from the sounds your heart and lungs make, such as what your doctor hears with a stethoscope at your yearly exam. Ingestion of a device like this would enable rapid and continuous sensing of vital signs in the field. From a single acoustic wave, we are able to distinguish heart rate and respiratory rate, which can be transmitted externally for potential remote access, processing, and evaluation. In a large animal model, we evaluated the fidelity of the signal in the fed and fasted state and demonstrated good accuracy in the GI tract. With the ability to continuously monitor vital signs without the need for a wearable device, we see significant applications in the defense industry in the monitoring of soldiers, and in healthcare for monitoring patients at home, for rapid triage in busy emergency rooms, or for trauma patients where skin contact is difficult or impossible. Finally, these technologies may be used by amateur and professional athletes where the monitor itself can drive further optimal training.
Okay. So now you can understand that like what IoT is going to like the impact we are going to have, like so it goes as a small data and comes out as a big data. Okay, so home, so I have categorized that into different areas. So the first one was the health, the second one was the home. So home, you know, like your home automation, and you have Vimo, some kind of plugs where you basically plug in some kind of electronic items where you can control that from your mobile device. So it works on a Wi-Fi, right? So likewise, keychain and so many other stuff. So avoid disasters, and you can have plans monitored. So I have seen this. So when I was in UK, like this Dish Telecom is using some of these sensors to basically monitor the plants and other stuff like that. Okay, so in the city, basically you can keep the city clean, like when the garbage lorry comes in, it depends on whether the dustbin is, whatever the garbage is, full or not. So many other areas are there. While at the construction, you can basically measure like street lights and so many other stuffs are there, pollutions and driving, so many other areas. So industry, you can use it for maintaining repairing of machineries, stop guessing, monitoring. So the construction where you can monitor whether this the mixture is in a correct order, correct composition or not. And in agriculture, safety aids. So many areas are there. So I'm not going to go deep into like explain what about this specific thing. So these are the areas where this IoT is going to have an impact. Right, so you can think about it's everywhere. Some of the interesting stuff like Bluetooth breathing device, so and Wi-Fi smart pen and Bluetooth. I hope you would have gone through this Bluetooth smart mug where you pour some liquid, it will tell you what that liquid is, right? And you have braille interface navigation where, like for blind people, it can basically sense some of the using the sensors and you can do something like that. And I don't know, this eye helmet, so that also is using some kind of sensors. Maybe the data is going to the cloud. I don't think it is not going to the cloud. So it may be useful at some point of time, right? So diabetes, device for diabetes, therapy management. So many areas. So the IoT is going to change the way in which where we are going to work, like how we are going to work. So now you know about IoT and how this IoT is going to basically send some data, and it is going to send some data to the cloud, right? Now, let's see about the connectivity of IoT, how it is going to work. Now, some of the devices, now if you look at some of the device by itself cannot connect to the cloud, okay? So in that case, you might need a gateway or some kind of a gateway where this, whatever the data which goes from that, whatever the IoT devices, it goes through a gateway, and from there, it goes to the cloud. So likewise, there are devices which can by itself, from the device itself, it can connect and it can basically send the data to the cloud. So if you look at the connectivity from some of the IoT device to the gateway, you can either use NFC, Bluetooth Low Energy, MQTT, SN, ZigBee, and so many other technologies are there for these devices to communicate with the gateway. So coming back to the communication protocols. So you can either use HTTP. HTTP is going to be bulky, but still there are systems which uses HTTP, MQTT, CoAP, and so many other protocols. Maybe you must be knowing some other protocols. Maybe you must be using your own proprietary protocol, which if you think it's more secure, okay? So, and DM protocols is for device management. So now these devices are connected, and how do you control this device now? Now, this device can be controlled using some of these device management protocols. So these device management are TR069, OMADM, lightweight M2M. So these are some of the protocols which are available to manage these devices. Okay. So apart from the communication, now you have another protocol which is to manage these devices. So now we have seen connected device.
I can't find the connection.
So, okay, so this is also some kind of a device which is trying to connect to the internet, trying to send some data, okay? So connected device communication, connected device data. Now you saw about IoT devices and how the data is going to come in and how the data is going to go and how to manage, how the protocol and so many other stuff. Now the real value of IoT will lie in analyzing the streams of information, because these devices are going to send every single minute. It may be like even lesser than that. It is going to keep on pushing data from that device to whatever the cloud, or it can be to the gateway, right? So the real value is basically is in analyzing the streams of information, right, to make a better and faster business decisions. Okay, so this is the problem we have figured out. Now let's see. So the problem associated with this, if you have a lot of internet devices, now it's going to be billion, right? So it's going to be about 40 billion devices. Now all these devices starts sending data to the cloud. That's going to be a major problem. Scalability issues, networking, storage, analyzing. You have to have huge amount of power to process their data. So many other issues are there. So these are some of the issues. So we need to figure out a way. Now it is not happening. So currently there's I don't see a huge traffic of data which is going from IoT device to the internet, but this will be happening in the next 2 to 3 years. Now you know the problem now, right? Now next 5 years we are going to face a huge problem. Now what is the solution? So what is the solution? So let's say a temperature sensor, some kind of a gadget which basically sends some temperature. Now it basically sends the data to the cloud, and then it goes to some of the backend, and then you do some analysis, and then you have some kind of data. So that's where this business, you're going to improve your business. So as I told you, the real value of IoT is the data analyzing part. Okay. Now, as you have seen in the previous slide, now there's some issues with this approach. Like every single minute, every single second, the data is going to go, and it's going to basically have a huge impact on the bandwidth of the network and the internet, and it's going to be a huge problem for us. Okay. Now, what is the solution? So you need to have some kind of filtering or some kind of intelligence happening before it goes to the internet. Okay, so you need to have some kind of, it's not really a filter, like let's say you have a sensor which is basically sending a temperature to the back end, say about every single minute, every single second it is going to send. So let's say 23 degree is going to be transmitted every single second, but the 23 is going to persist for almost 5 hours. So there's a wastage of data which is going to go, right? So why not send only the data only when there is a change? So that particular algorithm or particular the decision about what data you want to send from your IoT device based on the change of the temperature is up to you to come up with an algorithm, right? So not really a kind of a filter, it's more than that. So you can't write an application or something saying that, okay, if the temperature change, send something like that. You can have some kind of complex thing which basically based on the, I'm interested only this set of data. So based on this algorithm, I have to send this data, right? So these are some of the issues here. Now let's see the types of things which basically can solve this problem, right? Now there are devices, as I told you, like there are devices which can directly connect to the internet and basically send the data, right? The other one is like low power devices which want some kind of high computation, right? So there we have some kind of a gateway, right? Now there are gateways. Now let's see what are the gateways available. Now the term edge analytics. Now what is edge analytics now? Analytics at the edge. That means before the data goes to the back end. So you actually do your analysis part of the data. That's not the graph or something like that. You do some kind of filtration, or you kind of filtering some of the noisy data, right? So you filter some of the noisy data at the edge before it goes to the cloud. So that is called as edge analytics. So if you look at this edge analytics, it's basically a kind of a distributed thing, right? So you do your simple analytics on the device itself, and if it is a little bit complex, something which is really complex, you do at the gateway. And if you really want to do a big analytics, something like heavy lifting, something like that, you have to do that at the back end, at the cloud, okay? So which offloads the network and the data centers by creating a model that scales. So where you have some kind of control over the data which is going to go from the IoT device to the server. So now the next problem. Now how do you, like now there's going to be streams of data, like every single second your data from the IoT device is going to come in. Now you need to basically, it's a stream, right? Now how do you process this stream of data? So that's a challenge. So there are three different ways you can do it. So before that, you need to have some of these criteria which should be part of this. Process the data without storing. So you can't store the data in a database and do the processing, which is going to take a hell lot of time. It has to be very really fast. Then the queries has to be fixed, triggers when the conditions are met. Let's say if the temperature is more than something like that, or like let's say in this room the temperature, the minimal temperature should be around 22 to 26. If there is a fire, then the temperature goes up only at some condition, like let's say if it goes beyond 40, then something should be triggered. So those are the critical points where you need to find an algorithm to figure out like what had happened in the room, right? So technologies. So coming back to the technologies, how we can do this real-time analytics of the stream data? So there are three ways. One is stream processing. So where you have this Apache Storm and Apache Samza, and the second way is complex event processing, CEP. So we have this WSO2 CEP, Esper stream-based, and microbatch. You use Spark stream. That means you analyze the set of data based taking chunks of data, batches of data, and you do analyze, and then you combine together and do a final analysis, right? So let's see the comparison of these three techniques. Okay, the comparison is like the option one, Storm, you have to write code. Okay, so you have to write some Java code to do that, and yeah, you have to be a kind of a programmer or something like that to do processing of real-time data. The second one is like the Spark option is basically it's more compact than Storm, but you cannot do some stateful operations. Okay, so the third option is complex event. So this is the ideal thing which is available for us to do some kind of analytics on the real-time data, right? Where you don't have to write any coding or something like that. It's basically some kind of query, a simple query, right? So, and it's basically it's very easy to do that. Let's see how we can do that. So, if you take CEP, it's very similar to like the query which you are going to write is similar to SQL. Okay, so it will be something like this, and it's very expressive, short and sweet. You can define the core operation that covers 90% of the problem. So we are going to see how these things can be combined to solve some of the problems which we will be facing, right? So this is something like a simple SQL query. So you can see something like this, from T1 stock stream. So you can developing some application for RDBMS, so you basically define your database, right? So you basically create your database. Likewise, the stream is like you create a table sort of thing, right? So you create something like create table and the field names, right? Likewise, stream is also something like you define your stream, something like create table or something like that. So you create a stream and then you create whatever the field. Now here, this is the query which is basically going to basically extract those data and it is going to do the analysis on a real time. Okay. Okay. So still I have not come to the point where what we are doing, right? So now we have seen, okay, the penetration of connected device in the next 5 years. Right. So the summary of what we have what we have seen previously is we have there's going to be huge IoT devices. Now you saw about IoT, what is IoT, and how this IoT is going to basically send the data. Right. There are different ways to send the data. One is through the gateway, other one is directly to the cloud. And then we saw about the problems like how you are going to analyze the stream, like the stream of data. So there are three ways you can do. One is like the most suitable one is the CEP. And in the CEP also, like the ways you are going to analyze the data, or you are going to basically do that, is a simple query language, right? So like SQL. Now, so these are the things which we have seen. Now. So then we decided, like, why not? So there's going to be a problem, and these are some of the factors which we have to take into consideration before we do some kind of solution. Okay. So based on that, then we figured out that then we analyzed the market, and we found there's some kind of a hardware device. This is the first ever IoT edge analytics. It's not IoT stuff, right? It's an edge analytics device. Right, so they have created this device, and this device basically connects with all your IoT whatever the gadgets, and basically it's going to do some kind of analysis. Right, so it's a predefined thing, so you have to configure everything and you have to do this. Now this is really costly, right? So it's going to be about more than $100, and you have to basically send the data in a way that you have to do everything, you have to manually do that, right? So you have to configure, and the way the protocol works also, you have to basically from your IoT device, so you have to basically send the data in a format so that this edge analytics device will understand, okay? So, and this is a costly thing. Then we thought like, then we decided, okay, so we got an idea. So we thought like, why not we solve this in a simpler way, right? So then we started studying something. So let's see what. So any other simple solution? Then we started doing some research. Then we figured out, okay, the smartphone market, you know about Android. So Android is growing, and these are the device like percentage wise, it's 82.8. And then we figured out there's going to be huge amount of Android devices across different platforms. So you are going to have Google Glasses, you're going to have so many other watches, other stuff like even laptops, set-up boxes and TV. So many other devices are going to be there, right? Now, some of these devices are static. That means it won't move. Some of these devices are like mobile phones, which basically, which moves. Now, these devices will be having Android as the core operating system, right? Then we decided, why not? Because this has a high processing power. Now, we then decided, why not we write something, a kind of a service which can solve that problem, where we can connect multiple devices and basically do something. So this is not only the solution to do the edge analytics, but there are several use cases for that, whatever the services which we are going to build. So what we decided was, why not, like, so there is going to be, this is what our architecture is going to be like. So we have already started something, and by January it will be available. So let's see what is going to be available in January. Okay. So what we are trying to do is, now if you look at the architecture of Android, now you have this application framework, now you have all these services which will be running at the background, right? Some of this Android services. Now we are writing something called as Edge Analytics Manager. So which will be a service where, like, so once we develop that one, so we might talk with Google and figure out whether this, how it can fit into their protocol stack, and maybe they can use it. Now, to write this one, it's not easy. Now, you need to have your complex CEP engine. It takes a huge amount of time to write this. Okay. Now we already have a product CEP, which is like we took about at least 2-3 years to build that product, and we took some of the minimal features from that product. Okay, minimal features from that product which can do some kind of complex event processing. So this is going to be a service, and any application can use that service as a normal service, like whenever you want to basically have location manager or something like that. How do you call that? Like get service, some context dot or something like that. Likewise, you can also do that if you want to use analytics. Now let's see how you are going to do that. So Edge Analytics engine is an Android service which embeds a CEP complex event processing engine to process real-time stream data and trigger an event. Okay. Normally, if you are writing a location application, now you basically write an Android application. What you do is, like, you basically have a location sort of thing and a location manager, and then you basically register, and then there's a callback. Then whenever there's a something happening, whenever there's a location change, it will be triggered in your application. So that's very simple. So let's say you want to go to you want to know like whether this particular it's a Colombo or Candy or something like that. So you write something, some kind of coding. But assume, like, if you want something which is very complex, like I want to basically analyze something where if I stay in a particular location, that means if I am in Bumblebee for 10 minutes and do some kind of activity, so can I monitor that? You won't be able to do that. So if you want to do that, you have to write your entire code, you have to analyze your data, you have to put all your data in the database, and then you have to do a kind of lot of analysis. What if there is a service, if you say, okay, if I am in Bumblebee for more than 5 minutes in a single query statement, that's it, register for that service, and then you basically close your application. So this analytics engine basically will be processing that without storing the data in the database. It will be using the memory thing, and it's very lightweight, and whenever that particular condition is met, it will trigger your application. So that's going to be a useful thing, right? So the model one, so we have come up with some of the model. The model one is, now you can write your application. So Edge Analytics is a service which will be running. The model one, basically you will be having set of IoT devices which will be connecting through low energy, Bluetooth low energy, and you might write your application. and so which basically sends the devices basically send some data to the application. Now, to basically make use of the edge analytics engine, what you need to do is define a stream. What is the data which is going to come in? So defining a stream is nothing but defining a creating a table. Create table, whatever the data type, right? Likewise, the sensor is going to give you some kind of data, right? So it can be longitude or it can be latitude or some kind of data which is going to come in. So you basically have defined your stream, then you define your query. Then you have to define a query saying that, okay, based on a location or a time, you can define your query, okay? Then you basically register for a callback. Then you say, okay, if this condition is met, please call me. Okay, then you start sending the stream of data from your application to the edge analytics engine. So it's the functionality of the edge analytics engine to do all this processing and based on the query to trigger this device, so trigger this application, so that application can do some kind of action based on whatever the query you are passing. So this is one model. This model, the application defines a stream, defines a query and defines and also sends the data from the application to the edge analytics. So it is the application to send the data. Okay. Now the second model. So the second model is the edge analytics engine is running in Android. So you don't have to like sensors which is part of Android itself. So you can the edge analytics engine can get the data from location, sensors, so many other information. From the Android itself, right? So there are predefined some kind of activities or some kind of things which is already predefined based on location and sensors. So whenever you want to write an application, so let's say you are writing an application where you want to say, okay, if I'm so let's see the use case as well. So I'm going to give a sample use case in the next slide. So if you are in if you are in Bumblebee or some a place for more than 10 minutes or something like that, so you basically want to trigger something, right? So you are not going to send the data because you don't have to send the data, so you register for that and edge analytics engine will take care of that because the edge analytics engine has access to all this information because it's an Android application, okay? So this one, if you compare the previous one with this one, the advantage here is like not the advantage, the usage is basically you don't have to send the data, right? So if you think if your query or something, if your some criteria is based on location or some kind of sensors, it is part of Android, so you can use this model. The third model is you want to combine all these things. So sensor data is coming and you want to make use of these two things combined together and produce some kind of result out of it. Okay, let's see some of the use case. Only when you see the use case, you will understand, okay, why should I use this? Okay. Okay, so this is how you define. So this is how when you, if you look at the top coding, so location manager, this is how you define your location and you register for that and then basically some kind of longitude, latitude change is happening, right? Now if you look at this one, it's basically similar. Now since it is not a system service, so we basically have to basically in an application context, you have to write this one. So still we are polishing it. So you can basically write a stream name and define whatever the data. Right, whatever the data, and then basically you need to start it, and then basically, so with this 6 or 7 lines of coding, you can do so much of complex thing happening at the back end, right, from the service. So it is going to analyze the data, it is not going to store the data, and it's basically much faster than like what whenever if you try writing your code. Okay, and it's basically like you don't have to run your application in the foreground, you just register for this event and then basically it will be running like even if you close the application, automatically this will be triggered. You must be knowing this broadcast receiver, something like that. It will basically get activated and then you can do some actions based on this whatever the criteria I have defined. So let's see a use case. Well, let's say you are writing a sales automation, some kind of a system, so which where you in the car has OBD and you have a sales rep and he has an Android device and he has a, like he's basically traveling from some area. So early morning he starts from one area to another area, right? Now, so the criteria here is if the sales rep stays at a shop on the route for more than 20 minutes. Now, if you have to write that one, you have to write an entire code in New York. So this is also, you can do it. Like if you are writing an Android application, you can easily write this, right? So if you keep on getting all the data, put it somewhere in the database, and you basically analyze this and basically write it. So, right, it's where you can do that in a normal Android application, right? Now, so what happens if you have something like this? Can you do this? If the sales rep stays at a shop on the route for more than 20 minutes, if the past 10 sales is less than 50,000 average, so complex. Right? If you want to do that, you have to write the entire code. Now, here it's very simple. You define the stream, okay? Then you basically define the query, saying that, okay, if some kind of, so you have to learn that query and you write it, very simple, one line of code. Then you basically register that one and then basically execute it. And you can close your application. Automatically, this will be triggered. Or you can make your, like when the action is happening, it basically send a notification to the backend cloud. So you know this this sales rep is not performing well or something like that. So let's see some of the use cases as well. Okay, if the sales rep remaining visit count and the kilometer to reach along with time exceeds 100 kilometer per hour, then again a notification. So these are so these are complex thing which you can't do it, like in the sense, like you if you are trying to write it, you have to write a hell lot of coding and you have to do all these things, right? These are things which can be solved by CEP engine. So that's how. So we in the service, it embeds a CEP engine, and this CEP engine with this query, it will do all these kind of things. So we'll look into some of the use cases as well. So some of the functionality of CEP, so that any complex scenarios can be solved. See, the sales vehicle speed exceeds 100 km for 10 minutes. Continuously, his speed is increased or something like that, exceeds 100 km per hour. Okay. Alert the driver with bad driving behavior based on the OBD data and complex queries. So many things you can do with this. So which you, if you are writing your application, you won't be able to do that. But you can do it, but you have to like store it in a database, and you have to do so many other stuffs like so fraud detection. So you can so based on the location and type, you can do some kind of, like, let's say I have seen people saying that calling from they take a call from Colombo and they say, ah, yes, I'm calling from Dubai or something like, but you can still see the number. But there are things which are also happening like this. Now sales rep can also cheat like this. Now there are so many other incidents which has happened because of this fraud detection. So you can also track all these kind of the queries. You can combine all these and you can detect fraud. Okay. So one such example is credit card. Okay. So let's say you are making a payment through your credit card, right? So this is not with a mobile device. So I'm giving a normal example. So you are making a credit card transaction from Colombo, right? Then all of a sudden you are within 2 hours you are making a credit card transaction from US. Now that is not possible, right? But still you can use you can detect the location of the user, and you can easily figure out that. So the other one is MDM solution. Now, you know about mobile device management. So now you basically in a corporate, like you allow a BYOD, bring your own device. Now these devices basically are allowed to access corporate resources, right? So what happens is, now you can, every company has a policy saying that if you are connected within the company intranet or company network, you basically are giving access to some data, okay? And so there are criteria. You can say, okay, if the device is connected to the office from 5 to 8 with the same network, then you give access, okay? So there's a decision you need to take. So it acts as a policy manager, So you can define a policy, and we can basically push that policy to the analytics engine, where it basically analyzes based on the location, time, and so many other factors based on the data which is coming from the external source, and do some complex thing and basically trigger some event. Okay, these are complex things which you so we are using something for our MDM solutions. We are developing an MDM solution. We are using this analytics engine as a policy engine, which basically have some kind of policy like filtering based on location and time. So IoT gateway, you have seen, like, so there are sensors which are going to send huge amount of data, so you can basically filter that, and you can send only the data which is required at the back end. So some of the challenges we face is the size. So then so if you look at our CEP service, it was like optimized, and it now comes to 2 MB, so that is reasonable size. And so memory also, we are doing some testing. So if you ask me, like, last 10 hours how you are going to store the data and how you are going to do that, so there are some other ways to do that. Like, let's say a data comes in and you are writing a query, something like for the next 10 minutes, and basically you don't have to rely on the previous data. It will do some mathematical calculations based on the query you have defined, and keep the current data and keep a attribute based on that, and basically delete that event and basically get the next event and process that based on the attribute of that. So let's say event is coming, okay, you can have a count based thing, right? So let's say you want to monitor temperature, where for the past 10 values, it has to be, if it exceeds beyond 5, the variation is 5, then you trigger something. So what you can do is you can keep only one data value and basically have some counter and basically remove the rest of the data. So likewise, so many other optimizations are there, and we have figured, like, memory is also fine. If you look at the battery also, we are doing some testing on that. So these are some of the basic patterns. So this is the full set of patterns which is supported in the CEP. So in the mobile, some of these patterns are, like, we are going to observe, and we have taken already supporting some 4 to 5 patterns here. So there's something called historical data, comparing the historical data with the real data. So that concept is called as Lambda architecture, right? So you have some historical data and you have some real data, and you want to do some kind of comparison sort of thing. So we call that Lambda architecture. So that's where you interacting with the databases, prior pattern 6. So currently we don't have that. So likewise, the simple thing like filtering, joining event streams, alert thresholds. So some of the basic patterns are already, we have absorbed that into the mobile version of CEP, which is supported in the Edge Analytics service of Android. Okay, so the next phase. So what are we going to do with the next phase? So we are trying to bring the machine learning thing. So the current CEP version has machine learning extension. So what is machine learning? So the thing is, machine learning is you need a huge set of data, right? Now here we are not going to basically store the huge set of data in the mobile device, right? The huge set of data is going to the cloud, right? So let's say 1 month or 2 month or something, something like that, it goes to the cloud, and from there you derive a model out of it. So you have an expression which basically comes out of it, which is a small 1 or 2 page of some mathematical calculation. So we use that model, and with the CEP query, you can basically say, when the stream comes in, use this particular model to do the analysis, and based on that, you predict something. So for one such example is credit card. So you use a credit card, and you basically, you're trying to access the credit card from from location A, and then immediately you are accessing from location B, which is not like possible at all. So the other situation would be every user must be having a credit card pattern, right? Usage of pattern is basically he used to buy the credit buy something using this credit card from morning 9 to something like that. Now you have a pattern data like from 9 to some duration, some other criteria is also there, and all of a sudden he is trying to buy something from around 12 o'clock or 2 o'clock or something like that. Then you basically figure that out is an anomaly, and you say, okay, this is an anomaly, this is a normal, this is not a normal thing, this is some kind of anomaly. So so the mobile basically is not going to store the data, it is going to use the machine model, and basically you can combine these things and you can basically write a simple query, a complex sort of query in CEP, and which will be working as part of CEP inside the mobile. Okay, so this is what we are currently working on now. So the first phase is almost like we are finalizing on the coding stuff, and it will be available by January. So I hope that can solve so many other problems. So we'll be, I think there are so many other use cases. So you can think about it, like you when you're writing some application, when you're writing some kind of complex application where you want some kind of analysis of the data, you can use this. Okay, so anyhow, even if you start from scratch to write the CEP engine, that's pointless. So it's going to be open and open source, and so you can use that. And also, we will be talking with the Google guys, and we'll be trying to put that as part of maybe not in the next release, maybe in the next release, the coming release. Okay, so summary. So you have seen about the challenges the next 5 years. There's going to be huge amount of IoT devices coming, and you know what IoT is, and so much of data which is going to go from the IoT to the cloud. Some data might go, some data might not go, but most of the time there's a high possibility that all these data might go. Okay, now and you have seen the challenges, the scalability and the huge amount of data, the bandwidth, so many other challenges were there. Now, rather than sending all this data to the backend, so if you have some kind of analytics engine which can basically sit at the edge, that's called as edge analytics. And we also have seen so many other hardware vendors have started producing edge analytics hardware devices, which is going to be costly, and which is going to be like how you are going to use it is going to be another challenge. The protocol and how the connectivity. So why not use an existing technology which is already there, which is the Android, where you have static devices, where you have TVs, and so many other devices are going to come in, and maybe some kind of IoT Android thing which will also be coming very soon. So we are going to start our I think it's February, so we're going to start our Android internals. So that means we are going to start meetup where we are going to discuss everything about how to basically starting from putting an ASO, AOSP Android image, and using the firmware, how to build your own Android device. Right? Now we might basically put this and build some kind of Android device. Okay, so then we saw about the distribution of analytics. So if it is a low power device, now you can do some kind of analytics. That means filtering, if greater than this or less than that, some kind of simple thing. You can do that within the device itself and basically filter some data, you send some data, right? Now if you have some kind of complex scenarios, like if the value is greater than this for the past 10 minutes or past based on the location, some kind of complex analysis or some kind of complex processing has to be done. So to do that, you can use the gateway. right? So the gateway is nothing but a device which basically is going to collect the data from the IoT device, process that, and it is going to send the data backward to the cloud, okay? So then the heavy lifting part is done at the back end, the cloud server, where you do all the analysis of the data and you come up with the various reports, okay? Then we saw about CEPs, complex event processing, the advantage of using CEP for real-time data stream analysis, right? So, and how simple it is writing a simple query, writing like a simple query like SQL. And then we saw about this Android, what we are working on, and how this is going to solve some of the problems. It may, today it may seem it's a stupid idea or something like that, but we see a value on that. So, our future work on the edge analytics engine on machine learning, how we are going to bring the model and how we are going to do some kind of analysis based on the model. And we saw some of the complex use cases which can be simply done using this mobile analytics engine. Thank you very much. Any questions?